Good morning and welcome to the 10th meeting of the Constitution Europe External Affairs and Culture Committee. Our first item of business is the Continuity Act Draft Policy Statement and Draft Annual Report. On the 29th of October, the Draft Policy Statement and Draft Annual Report on the use of the Keeping Pace Power in the European Union Continuity Scotland Act 2021 were laid in the Scottish Parliament. As part of our scrutiny on the draft documents, the committee will hear this morning from Professor Kenneth Armstrong, Professor of European Law, University of Cambridge, and Mary Snowden, Director of the Human Rights Consortium Scotland. I welcome you both for the meeting and thank you for your briefings for today's meeting. I'm going to move straight to questions from our members, but if I could start with a question to Mary initially. In your submission, you highlight one of the key areas of the debate during the Continuity Bill passage through Parliament was transparency and the openness of decision-making and how stakeholders in Civic Scotland would be involved in that process. I wonder if I could just ask you to elaborate on that, those thoughts.
Thanks, Convener. Thanks for the invitation to speak with you today. Right from throughout the Brexit process, one of our members' biggest concerns has been around keeping up with the EU and not lagging behind. And so we were really pleased to see the Keeping Pace powers in the Continuity Bill and in the Act. But I think one of our concerns now is looking at that draft policy statement and at the draft annual report, is just that we're left with lots of questions. So we think transparency and scrutiny of the decision making around when to align and not to align is really crucial for making sure that we align wherever that means it will advance or maintain rights and standards. And it's very difficult to see from that policy statement or the annual report if that's happening, how that's happening, or the criteria being used around those decisions. They're really just left with lots of questions, and that's concerning for transparency. And the other question we have around, there is a mention of consultation, but again, little detail of what that means or looks like, and how the Scottish Government are keeping up with what's going on in the EU. We mentioned in our evidence as well around the National Mechanism for Monitoring, Reporting and Implementation, which is something the Scottish Government has committed to consider and to consider specifically that it will monitor EU developments. And so the fact that it's not mentioned in this policy statement, I would be interested to know some more detail about that as well. So I think it's just that openness and transparency to know what decisions are being made and why when it comes to keeping up with rights and standards.
Thank you. If I could ask Professor Armstrong, in your role as advisor to the Session 5 Finance and Constitution Committee, you highlighted the impact which the Market Access Principles in the UK Internal Market Act could have on policymaking in Scotland. So in considering the Scottish Government's commitment to keep pace with EU law, how might that be impacted by the Market Access Principles?
Good morning, Convener, and it's a real pleasure to appear before you this morning, and thank you very much for the invitation. I think as the policy statement itself says, there is a possibility that ministers' exercise of their discretion to align or not will be impacted by considerations of the UK Internal Market Act. And before developing that, just to kind of develop the point that Mary was making, I guess one question you might want to ask is, well, when would we know that? When would we know that ministers were deciding not to exercise their powers because they felt that there was a constraint emanating from the UK Internal Market Act? Or when is it simply an exercise of policy discretion by Scottish ministers? So knowing where that lies, I think, is important. But certainly, if the powers were to be used and in a way that gave rise to an internal divergence, so alignment with the EU, but internal divergence within the UK, that could, of course, then trigger the market access principles. So the question will be, well, in what circumstances may that happen? What would be a good example of that? Because obviously it has to be something that is within devolved competence. which is also going to give rise to change at EU level. I think there may be a number of examples. You probably have heard some of these before, but some of the issues round about the use of plastics and even microplastics in products. And perhaps also, and something which is in the Commission's work programme for the forward look for next year, is round about plant seeds, the marketing of plant seeds and revisions to that legislation, which would fall within devolved competence, and where the Scottish ministers to seek to align with any new position under EU law that could then potentially trigger the application of the market access principles under the UK Internal Market Act.
Thank you very much. I'm going to move to questions from the committee. Can I say, I should have said, Mr Golden is delayed by travel problems this morning, but we're hoping he will join us at some point this morning. And can I invite Ms Boyack to ask her?
Thanks very much. It's very useful to read your paper to us this morning. I suppose I'm thinking about the transparency issue that I think both of you have just mentioned about how is this tracked and the extent to which the Scottish Government makes public the different calculations it has in terms of new EU legislation. You've mentioned a number of different issues, deposit and return scheme, minimum unit pricing and water services. I was wondering if you could say a little bit more about the water services issue and how you think we would track that particular issue, given the range of key players involved across Scotland who would have a very strong interest in that issue, both in terms of businesses, local authorities, Scottish Water, and then environmental campaigners?
Thank you. I mean, I think the water services issue is somewhat separate from the keeping pace. It's not necessarily something that would change because Scottish ministers were doing something under a keeping pace power. The point that I was trying to illustrate in that example was that issues of services, we tend to focus on issues round about goods, I think, an awful lot when we think about the UK Internal Market Act, but we also need to think about services. And the way in which the Act is structured is that it is true that certain aspects of water policy are excluded from the operation of the Act, but not excluded from issues of authorisation to supply water services. And in depending upon how the Act was interpreted, was it open to say that a water company authorised to provide services in England or Wales would also be able to seek to offer those services in Scotland, despite the fact, as we know, we have a public service provider of water services in Scotland. So I'm not sure that I see that this is directly linked to the keeping pace power. It's just another example of the way in which the Act, the UK Internal Market Act itself, opens up devolved policy-making choices to potential regulatory competition within a UK internal market, and that clearly has implications for how devolved powers are exercised. I've described this elsewhere as being, you know, a kind of a competitive model of economic unionism rather than a more collaborative one in which we look to, for example, the common frameworks process as a way of trying to establish intergovernmental cooperation.
So just to follow up, your issue is not about the water quality and that regulation, it's about supply of water. Just trying to clarify, just reading your briefing to us.
Yeah, on the I think, as I say, on the water quality side of things, that is clearly a regulatory activity that would fall under the Act within the non-discrimination principle. And there, the non-discrimination principle, it is clear that water aspects of water services are, in fact, excluded from the operation of those principles.
OK, whereas in the other issues you mentioned in terms of deposit return scheme and minimum unit pricing, you also mentioned the issue of potential legal challenges. Do you want to say a little bit more about that?
I can do so quite briefly. Bearing in mind that the briefing that I think you've seen was written when the bill was in the Commons, and there were, of course, subsequent changes made And in fact, Michael Gove appeared before the Finance and Constitution Committee to confirm that as regard minimum unit pricing, that would now not fall within the mutual recognition principle, although it could fall within the non-discrimination principle. So it could be that further changes in the minimum unit pricing after the review that will take place between 22-23, that could potentially fall within the non-discrimination principle, in which case, a bit like the earlier Scotch whisky case, it would be up to courts to establish whether the Scottish Government's approach was compatible with the Act. I think the bigger issue is undoubtedly the deposit and return scheme regulations, which will become coming on stream from the beginning of 2022. And there, I think there is very obvious and very clear scope for producers outside of Scotland to seek to rely upon the Act in order to disapply and, in fact, fundamentally undermine core aspects of the regime that is established. And in the briefing paper that you've seen, I set out the different bits of those regulations that I think would trigger the Act.
Thank you.
Okay. So, Ms. Snowden, did you want to comment on any of those issues from...
One comment then about the transparency in the midst of such complexity, that it's really important, more important than ever, I think, that the Scottish Government are particularly clear and public in terms of their decision making, in order that they can be held to account on what they've said that they'll do and that they're doing it. I think that's ever more important, and particularly important because there's a real struggle amongst civil society organisations to follow what's happening in the EU. There's so much law and policy there to understand the internal markets and how that acts and how that applies and all of that complexity. There must be transparency and real public criteria about the around decision making.
What would work for you in terms of transparency? A website that set out issues that were being looked at, maybe our traffic light system, so you could see where there wasn't going to be change, where there was change being considered and where change was likely to be implemented, so that your members and wider civic society could actually be consulted about that. What would work in terms of the vast range of different organisations in terms of the resources that different members of your organisation, for example, have, whether it's environmental or the human rights angle?
Yeah, absolutely. So something simple and straightforward to be able to access at any time and know what's going on. I appreciate that these annual reports, for example, in the Keeping Pace powers, that was one of the purposes. So it's that regular kind of reporting and transparency. But as it stands, the one that we have says that there's been no consideration, and it makes you wonder what does no consideration mean. So absolutely, something like a website, something just clear about maybe the forums where they will raise these and get inputs from other people. And as I mentioned, there is that plan. There's been a proposal and an acceptance of to consider a national mechanism for monitoring, reporting and implementation around human rights specifically, and that will include kind of at UN and international level, but it was meant to include around developments of the EU, and that mechanism would be a way of making things more transparent. So I think there's lots of ways it can be done, but definitely something that's accessible, that people can see, that they can hold them to account through.
Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. Can I bring in Dr. Allen, please?
Thank you. A question for Ms. Snowden, just touching on the issue that you raised there earlier on about what could be done in Scotland to explain and publicise the issue of keeping track with or keeping up with, finding what European legislation there is to keep up with. I wonder, can you maybe just explain a bit for us what it is, if anything, at this stage that the UK, with its residual representation in the EU, is doing to actually keep track of legislation and whether there's anything to publicise it?
No, I mean, that's a good question. I'm not sure. I've been involved in lots and lots of Brexit discussions throughout the sort of process and work closely with colleagues across the UK. There's certainly not that same discussion, as far as I understand it, from what I've been involved in around that keeping pace So I couldn't answer for the UK, but clearly in Scotland we have a commitment to align where it makes sense, which is really positive from a sort of human rights point of view. And that's where we want to know what is happening then and the decisions that are being made.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Cameron.
Thank you and good morning to both of you. My questions are, I think, for Ms. Snowden, and it's around your comments in your submission on consultation. It's a point that COSLA also make. COSLA, in their submission, I think, say that they are anxious to consult, but that they haven't really had the opportunity to do so. Given that we, I think, as everyone accepts, EU law is rapidly changing body of law, and you know there are every year huge amounts of material. Can I just ask you about the practicalities of consultation? How do you see that best happening?
Yeah, I think often when we think of consultation, we think of a consultation document that goes out and you've got a couple of months to respond, and that is absolutely appropriate sometimes. But I think for this, because of the amount, as you say, of EU law and policy and the considerations that need to happen, I think it would be helpful to ask the Cabinet Secretary around what forums they will use to have those discussions about what's most appropriate, about the impact of different elements of EU law could have on people's lives, and to consider it in that way. So what would really advance people's rights and their lives here? So what forums, like, for example, there isn't a forum at the moment around keeping up with the EU and the voluntary sector, but there definitely could be, and that would be really valuable. So it could be more discussion forums as well as formal consultations. I think it could be a whole range of things, and I don't underestimate the extent of EU law and policy, but nonetheless, there will only be some that fall within devolved competence. There's lots of criteria that can be applied to be able to identify some key ones for discussion.
Thank you for that. I mean, it strikes me that the standard consultation that we're all used to, where the government publishes a paper and invites responses within a certain timescale, just won't work for this kind of thing, given that it's a constantly evolving subject. And forums, I think, is definitely one way forward. I'm just interested in the practicalities of how that happens between civil society or COSLA and government. Do you have any further thoughts?
Yeah, I think this, the national mechanism that I spoke about, is one way of doing that. So there'll be a particular resource set up that will have a core function of monitoring EU policy and having those discussions to make sure it's clear. I think there's things about the links that the Scottish Government have with the Fundamental Rights Agency at EU level, and how they are monitoring what they're working on and what comes out of there. And in terms of just the practicalities of consultation, I think there are good examples across government where they do have different forums where they bring things to the table to discuss. So I think there's definitely kind of practical ways of doing that, where they can identify some key issues possibly and then invite comments on them and discussion around it.
My final question is for Professor Armstrong. In your submission, Professor Armstrong, you write about the application of the market access principles, and you discussed that already this morning. One thing I'm interested in pursuing is the TCA, and whether you think, in terms of keeping pace, what implications the TCA will have for keeping pace powers.
Thanks very much. It's a very interesting question. I think what is clear about the TCA in its design was that it was designed to give the UK as a whole the greatest autonomy to decide its future regulatory policy. And as a consequence of that, there is limited constraints built into the TCA on that exercise of regulatory autonomy. There are, of course, the level playing field obligations, which, as you know, cover competition, state aid, environmental and labour standards. The requirement generally on labour and environmental standards is, of course, to maintain the the level of standards as they stood at the time at the end of transition. Any significant divergence can trigger different mechanisms under the TCA. So it's a way of trying to some degree manage divergence, but it doesn't. What is crucial is that it doesn't mandate alignment, and that it is the TCA's mechanisms are only a means of managing divergence. So from that point of view, alignment as a policy choice remains open to Scottish ministers. The constraints are less likely to arise, I think, from the TCA directly. They're more likely to arise just, I think, in terms of where policy is moving generally in that area.
Thanks. Mr. Ruskell?
Yeah, thanks. I was going to ask you about not just about alignment in terms of second legislation that's coming through directives, but also about how those laws, once they're in domestic legislation, are then being interpreted. And I'm aware that, for example, with environmental legislation, you know, there are often different interpretations of the habitats regulations, which then go to the EU Commission, and you know, there are often petitions and concerns about, for example, licensing the killing of certain species or whatever. So I'm just sort of wondering whether you feel that's another area where there potentially could be a divergence in terms of the interpretation of laws that originally came from Europe but are now in our domestic legislation and perhaps could be open to different interpretation.
So we know from the UK legislation that dealt with the UK's withdrawal that existing EU case law would be retained as retained EU case law up until the point that it stood at the end of the end of the transition period. Thereafter, UK courts are of course not bound by future developments in EU case law. And even as regards existing case law, there is a mechanism for the highest courts to depart from that case law for good reasons. And I think, as you may be aware, there is, I think, some desire at UK level to relax that even further. There was a consultation on doing that last year. It only relaxed to some degree. I'm not sure that I think courts are necessarily in a big hurry to want to be the leaders on issues of coming up with new and radical reinterpretations of this. I think they are very sensitive to the fact that these are significant policy questions within the UK and between the UK and the EU. The Court of Appeal in England was recently asked to exercise its power to diverge from previous case law, and it didn't find any good reason for doing so. So it didn't indicate that it was in much of a hurry to do so. But I think what you highlight is something very important in that we've got a scrutiny mechanism contained within the Continuity Act that is very narrowly focused on a particular type of use of a particular power in respect of alignment. And I think what is very clear from the policy statement and from the answers that Mary has given this morning as well is that the landscape of alignment is much broader than that. It can happen in all sorts of different ways, and it can be through case law, it can be through DOFT law, policy guidance, etc. And I think what is really lacking now is a framework for analysing what explains why alignment does or does not happen. And the way in which the Act, the architecture of the Act is focused, is in fact likely to be avoided in many circumstances, because as we know from the statements we've got and the annual report, is there's no exercise of that power at the moment. But what we don't know is beyond that, in terms of primary legislation, as you indicate, potentially changes in case law or changes in guidance, are there things happening out there within the wider environment that this Parliament isn't being able to scrutinise in the way that you may want it to? And the kind of monitoring mechanism that Mary described is, I think, a very interesting and important one. One thing just to say very quickly is, of course, there is a Commission annual work programme that tells us a forward look as to what's coming down the line. I think some mechanism of monitoring that to see how much of that is of relevance to Scotland and what would explain why Scottish ministers decide whether by regulations or by legislation to align or not to align, and some scrutiny round about that. So I think the architecture contained in the Act is a useful one, but only for that very small thing. And therefore, it's about expanding that architecture into a broader scrutiny framework.
I'm just thinking there also, as you're speaking about, you know, what the role is for wider public bodies as well. So you're sticking with the environment. I would presume that, you know, CEPA and Nature Scot were very aware of, you know, any decisions that are coming out of the Commission or the European Court of Justice on environmental regulations, that they would, I presume, wish to be aware of, or at least to flag to ministers if there was a potential for divergence over, say, species licensing proposals or whatever. And also, I mean, if you've got any thoughts on the role of Environmental Standards Scotland, because, you know, the Commission's gone, we've got Environmental Standards Scotland now. You know, are they part of, should they be a more full part of this architecture of scrutiny and understanding what alignment actually means on the ground?
One thing that the legacy report from the Finance and Constitution Committee was very aware of was that stakeholders, broader stakeholders, had good information resources, which would be very helpful for a committee like your committee to be able to tap into, in terms of acquiring knowledge about what is changing in the policy landscape. And the kinds of ideas that Mr. Cameron, I think, was talking about in terms of forums or bringing together the different bits of the sectors, whether it's ministers, public agencies, third sector organisations like the ones that Mary represents, in some form of forum, possibly prior to ministers producing their reports, in a sense to try and bring the relevant stakeholders together to say, well, what would be a good reason for aligning? And is there consensus on why actually alignment may not be required because of the balances that the statement says has to be drawn between not just the desire to align, but also the financial implications, other sorts of risks, etc. And in a sense, I think having a very open forum discussion between relevant stakeholders, public and private, would be a very useful way of informing the policy process as to when should alignment happen and when should it not happen, and would also help, I think, scrutiny then of the key choices that the Scottish Government is making.
My last question was just around how this works with other countries that are perhaps, you know, aligned, perhaps part of an acquis with the European Union, but are not, you know, in the European Union. So those in EFTA, you know, Norway, other countries who I know have a presence in Brussels, and obviously stay, keep very well informed about policy development in Brussels. Like how they've dealt with this question, how they're staying aware of policy changes, and how they're then developing those discussions with their own stakeholders and with their own public bodies.
The EFTA example is very, very specific. So the Norway, for example, there is, of course, a requirement to align with rules that fall within the scope of the European Economic Area Agreement. So from that point of view, because there is an actual requirement to align rather than a discretion, the flow of information is, of course, much more specific. And also there are different ways in which Norwegian parliamentary committees are locked into the kind of parliamentary framework that also applies to the European Economic Area Agreement. So in a sense, although outside of the EU, there is a structural institutional framework that allows for that flow of information. And I think what is very, very apparent is that outside of the European Union, the UK doesn't have the same access to that flow of information. And parliamentary structures, UK Parliament, Scottish Parliament, are highly reliant upon whatever it is that governments can provide to you by way of information. And I think the question you might pose, and I think the one that again Mary raised in her remarks, is there a role for civil society actors to do some sort of kind of shadow monitoring to some degree, and again to help provide you as parliamentarians with the kinds of information and resources you need to provide effective scrutiny and not be solely reliant on ministerial conduits of that kind of information.
Wants to come in on the points that Mr. Ruskell was reading.
Sorry, was that?
I was just wondered if you wanted to. We're talking a lot about the transparency issues. I just wondered if you wanted to respond to Mr. Ruskell as well. Sorry.
Sorry, I just missed the beginning of the question for some reason. I agree with everything the professor has just said, and I think what is interesting, I think the civil society do have a role and can have a role in helping the parliament to scrutinise government decision making in this area. I do think it's a huge challenge and one that the Scottish Government should think about in terms of how they resource civil society organisations, those that they fund already. Are they encouraging them to continue to be involved, for example, in a European network? That's one of a major concern, and with a lot of organisations that, as we moved out of the EU, would they still be able to be members of these European? Some of them are EU networks, some of them actually are Europe wide, and they continue in. But it's really important that they stay completely plugged into those in order to have that depth of insight and information that they can use for the purpose of scrutiny. So I think they've got a key role to play in all of that.
Not plugged into, or we're unplugging from at the moment. Are there any networks that we're unplugging from at the moment?
Sorry, I missed the beginning of the question again for some reason. So I don't have specifics, but I know that there has been quite a lot of concern about making sure where there are EU specific networks that some of them have taken the position, you know, that actually UK organisations can no longer be a part, understandably. Others have given kind of association kind of agreements where they've recognised the benefit of that. Certainly that's something that SEVO have been looking into quite closely. It's definitely a concern, because it's one other kind of example of the sort of side institutions, if you know what I mean, to the EU that we now stand outside of. Mm-hmm.
Thanks.
Okay, thank you. Ms. Mintle?
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for joining us this morning. Mr. Ruskell's questions overlap with the one that I was wanting to ask. I was interested, Vary, in the evidence that you've given with regard to advancing human rights. And my questions were going to be along the lines of how are you able to continue to plug in to what is happening within the EU and around about the world? And I think unless there's anything you specifically want to add to that.
It's just one other point is that it's also about the funding and resourcing of organisations to be able to do that. And that has been a concern, because we're no longer within EU funding structure, so structural funds and all of the aspects of law. So one of the things that we flagged up in our recent report of kind of questions arising out of Brexit was just that. So what will is the Scottish Government monitoring the loss that is in terms of both of EU funding to the third sector? What will be the loss of that, but specifically in terms of the loss of these European connections then, and the resources to be able to really engage in that?
Okay, thank you. I was also interested, and this is myself coming from a place of I'm learning very much every day about with regards to this. The Istanbul Convention, now it came in, it was signed by the UK government in June 2012, but as you comment in your evidence, that it's yet been ratified. My question is are conventions like that something that the Scottish Parliament could make a decision on ratifying? I don't know, Mr. Arm, Professor Armstrong.
Mm-hmm. Is that a question to me?
Yes, sorry,
it keeps coming in now. The Istanbul Convention would have to be something that was decided by the UK Parliament because it's an international treaty, and the UK government has signed it but not yet ratified it. And actually, that's really disappointing because we're coming up to 10 years since it was signed. And part of the reason for that is that they're working towards compliance before ratifying is their approach, but there is a great deal of concern now that actually they just need to progress with ratification, that this is absolutely necessary, you know, 10 years on and we're beginning to be left behind. So it's a really good example of actually of where if we were still in the EU, there would be more kind of expectation and pressure, you know, the EU is asking all member states to ratify the convention, but the UK has not yet done so. So certainly a concern that this should happen soon and before 10 years come up, which is June next year.
Thank you.
Okay. I don't know if Professor Armstrong wanted to comment on those questions.
I've got nothing to add to what Mary said.
Okay. I wonder if I could return, Professor Armstrong, to something you were saying earlier on, specifically, and you did say, obviously, this would be about devolved issues that the Scottish Parliament would be, Scottish Government would be looking at. But so much of this is dependent on the operation of the TCA. There's also the PPA delegation, which won't involve the devolved the devolved legislatures across the UK and will come from Westminster. So it's very much a hypothetical, but if the common frameworks don't work and we have a situation where Scottish Government wants to align with the EU in a devolved area, but an executive power is used at Westminster, do you foresee that as a potential? What would be a conflict resolution in that kind of situation?
So the common frameworks are there on the assumption then that different jurisdictions within the UK have powers and authority to enact rules in areas, and is a way of trying to at least seek consensus where it's possible on common approaches, but also to allow divergence where that is legitimate. Where that divergence then happens, then that in itself isn't the end of the matter, in the if the Scottish Government then does decide to do something different. So, for example, on the, I think I mentioned the Commission's work programme has something about revising the marketing of seeds legislation. That is something which falls within the scope of one of the provisional common frameworks at the moment. It may well be that will be taken forward on a kind of common approach. But if it doesn't, then, of course, Scottish ministers may decide to do something somewhat different. If they do so, then the question is that exercise of power constrained by other means, particularly by other legal instruments? Could it be constrained by the UK Internal Market Act? Would there be anything within the TCA? I don't think there would be. But we always, I think, in the point I think you're really highlighting is that with all of these situations, we need to kind of start with what happens when the power is exercised, and therefore work out what are the range of constraints that may exist round about it. And of course, the other level of constraint might be other international trade agreements, because of course, remember that this will be something that will be done at a UK level, negotiated by the UK government, with any scrutiny of that really largely done by the Westminster Parliament. And anything that is an obligation under an international agreement is something which can be enforced to constrain the exercise of devolved powers. It has to be compatible. There are powers in Scotland that to compel compliance. So I think we need to always be aware. I think it's always very difficult for all of us when we're trying to get our heads around any particular piece of any of this, that we don't end up with little silos of bits of information. And in a sense, the real challenge is trying to put together the complexities of where does the power lie and what are the range of potential constraints that may lie round about it?
Thank you. I'm looking to members to see if they've got any. Yes, Mr. Golden. Yeah.
Thank you, convener. I've got a specific question for Professor Kenneth Armstrong. It's very helpful in the briefing paper to give some three interesting case studies, and I was quite interested around the deposit return scheme issues around if the non-discrimination principle applies. Is there anything that we can do in advance of that to safeguard against potential legislation or litigation? And if not, is there a potential that the scheme would need to be delayed until that litigation was and the court ruled in terms of which principle might apply?
Interesting question. I mean, I think you know, the regulations are there; they will come into force, and it's in everyone's interest that they're applied. The question then would be: well, what should happen should a producer of a soft drink from another part of the UK seek to argue that they can avoid the requirements, for example, to register with SEPA? Or to have their product authorised for to be placed on the Scottish market. At that stage, it would be for any court to entertain any questions as to any interim measures that the claimant may seek by way of suspension of the operation of the regulations pending any final outcome. And in many ways, I think. What is clear from that, and I completely understand your question in the sense of, is there anything we can do to anticipate any of this? But what is very key about the UK Internal Market Act as a technique for managing this internal market is that it's after the fact. It assumes that there are regulations, that are new regulations come into force, and then we just have to deal with the consequences, with all the uncertainties that that litigation may throw up, rather than the kind of ex-ante approach of common frameworks, which is, we're thinking about putting in place new rules. Is there any risk of any divergence creating a problem? How do we manage that? And any UK internal market that is built solely on this kind of ex-post litigation strategy will create all the types of legal uncertainty that your committee has already heard about. I know you had evidence last week from the food and drink industry, from the Law Society of Scotland, and somebody, I think one of the alcohol awareness groups. And you know what is very clear, I think, from their evidence is this question of uncertainty. And any strategy that relies purely on litigation as a way of managing divergence is always going to create that uncertainty within the environment, and that's not necessarily a good thing.
Thank you, convener.
Thank you. Ms. Boyack, did you want to come back in?
Yeah, just very struck by that comment that you just made there in terms of just before Maurice Golden came in about the constraints. Professor Armstrong, and I'm thinking about if you were framing it in a different way about thinking about opportunities, how you would do that, rather than looking at what you can't do, looking more at what you could do in the context of priorities by the Scottish Government.
Absolutely right, and I think that's one of the reasons why the idea of having some novel style of forum would be really useful to really kind of push and tease out, well, what are the opportunities here and what would explain why we shouldn't take those opportunities? And I think it would be a useful, you know, I think in all walks of life, it's always good to have a degree of professional challenge. And I think bringing together a range of well-informed stakeholders that would provide a degree of challenge to say, well, but
What would be the what when you say there's a risk? What is that risk? What is the risk of aligning, or what is the risk of not aligning? And how are there ways of managing or mitigating those things? How could we? What, in a sense, perhaps one of the more interesting ways of presenting all of it might be, and I don't know whether Mary would agree with this or not, but is also to look at the European Union, not just through the lens of kind of compliance and alignment, but learning. Mm-hmm. Are there things we could just learn about, including their failures? And let's be honest about that too, that we don't just learn always assuming that the European Union's regulatory models are successful. They may have limitations too. Are there things we can learn from these experiences? And building in strategies that are provide better information, allow degrees of challenge and degrees of learning from the experiences of our nearest neighbour, I think in some ways would help reframe some of these issues and also to some degree depoliticise it. Because it's clear that the questions of alignment and divergence in this immediate post-Brexit period can, of course, become highly politicised. If we change the narrative somewhat and think about, well, what might we want to learn from these experiences, it might be a way of also building a greater degree of consensus.
Thanks very much. That's a really insightful comment. Could also apply to within the UK as well. It's interesting in terms of cross-government and cross-parliamentary scrutiny and accountability. Thanks very much.
Ms Snowden, do you want to comment finally?
Yeah, just going to agree absolutely with that learning point. And I think absolutely within the UK, absolutely on human rights. Progress and developments, we learn all the time. We learn within civil society. We constantly have discussions with Northern Ireland, Wales, England, and in terms of learning around human rights developments, and that's absolutely true of the EU as well. To flag up, the EU is no human rights organisation, and it might not be that actually everything that they do we would want to align with if we have a core commitment to progressing human rights, but nonetheless, there's definitely learning and there's definitely elements that we want to take on and embrace because they are good for making rights real in people's lives here.
Okay, thank you very much. I don't see any more questions coming from the committee. Can I thank both Professor Kenneth Armstrong and Mary Snowden for their attendance at committee this morning. It's been a very, very helpful session, and I'll suspend briefly to allow the new witnesses to come in. I welcome everyone back. The committee will now move to its second agenda item on the Continuity Act Draft Policy Statement and Draft Annual Report, and we will hear from the Cabinet Secretary for the Constitution, External Affairs and Culture on the Continuity Act. The Cabinet Secretary is joined this morning by George McPherson, Head of Policy and Alignment, Scottish Government, and Lorraine Walkinshaw, Scottish Government Legal Directorate at the Scottish Government. Can I welcome you all to the meeting this morning, and Cabinet Secretary can invite you to make an opening statement.
Very much, Convener. Today we're focusing on the European Union and in particular alignment with European Union laws and standards. The background to this, of course, that the people of Scotland have made clear on a number of occasions, not least in the Brexit referendum, that Scotland should continue to be a part of the European Union. And the Scottish Government believes that the people of Scotland should have the right to choose their future as an independent nation, which is a member state of the European Union in its own right, and we'll continue to advocate for Scotland's place in Europe and the world. We're committed to remaining close to the European Union in the meantime, and to build the strongest possible relationship between the EU and Scotland, and we've demonstrated this in many ways, from our policy choices to our investment in our enhanced overseas presence and our commitment to giving the warmest of welcomes to EU nationals. This approach lies behind our policy to maintain alignment with the European Union where appropriate, in a manner that contributes towards maintaining and advancing standards across a range of policy areas. We'll do so to protect the health and well-being of people in Scotland and maintain Scotland's international reputation as inclusive and outward-facing. By protecting and continuing to advance the high standards that Scotland enjoys, we will also ease the future process of Scotland's return to the European Union. We are doing this in a whole range of ways, in our policies, in our grant giving, in our guidance, and in our practice. We will take as a default the measures adopted by the European Union. We support EU standards and hope soon to be applying them here. And of course, the same will apply when we come to relevant legislation, and I think this lies at the heart of this morning's evidence session. For nearly 50 years, Scotland formed an integral part of the European Union. EU law either had direct application here, or we were obliged to implement it into Scots law by powers granted under the European Communities Act 1972. Since the UK has left the European Union, ministers have replaced that obligation with a policy to continue to align devolved law with the EU where that's appropriate, in other words, where it is possible and within Scotland's interests to do so. This acknowledges a number of factors, and I think this is at the nub of the issue before us. First, in some cases, literal application of EU law to Scotland may not be possible due to the current context of Scotland's and the UK's status as a third country post-EU exit. For example, the law may not have been designed to be applied outside member states of the EU. Secondly, the Scottish Government may be constrained from doing so due to international or existing legal obligations, in particular reservation by Westminster. Thirdly, a combination of circumstances, including, for example, the operation of the UK Internal Market Act, may mean that ministers judge that alignment of legal texts is not in Scotland's overall interest for that particular law under the current constitutional dispensation. In such cases, ministers may judge that, due to circumstances out with our control, a level of divergence is within Scotland's interests. However, such an approach will always seek to preserve the values and outcomes we share with the European Union, from tackling the global climate emergency, protecting our environment, supporting smart, sustainable economic growth and recovery from the pandemic. Scotland will not deviate from these common aims. In short, we need to be clear that the power in Section 1(1) of the Continuity Act provides us with an important means of achieving alignment, but it is not the only means of achieving this. The policy statement sets out that our starting point is to align via policy development. If a law is required, primary legislation may be more appropriate in some instances, and the preference is that specific domestic powers should be used for making secondary legislation if available. This does not mean that the power in 1(1) is unimportant, far from it. It provides an important backstop when a legislative change is needed to align, but primary legislation is not necessary and subject-specific enabling powers are not available or not appropriate. Although we have not yet needed to call upon the power provided in Section 1 of the Act, this is critical in maintaining the Scottish Government's ability to make subordinate legislation where appropriate in order to ensure that we can keep devolved Scots law aligned with EU law as it develops. We'll not hesitate to use the power in future where appropriate and necessary. Let me turn briefly to the two documents before you today, Convener. Part 1 of the UK Withdrawal from the European Union Continuity Scotland Act 2021 requires that Scottish ministers publish a statement of their policy on the approach to be taken, the factors to be taken into account, and the process to be followed when considering whether to use the power under Section 1(1). Prior to the policy statement being published, it must first be laid in draft before the Scottish Parliament. This statement is laid in draft in accordance with Section 7(3) of the Act for a period of 28 days, and I look forward to considering members' representations on the draft in preparation of the policy statement, which will be laid before the Scottish Parliament for approval. Part 1 of the Act also requires Scottish ministers to prepare and lay before the Scottish Parliament a report explaining how the Section 1(1) power has been used during the reporting period, how it's been considered for use, and how it's planned to be used over the coming reporting year. This report must also set out how the use and planned use of the power has furthered or will further the purpose of the power in Section 1 to contribute towards maintaining and advancing standards mentioned in Section 2 of the Act. Finally, convening the Scottish Government's first draft report covers how the Section 1 regulation making power has been used since its commencement on the 29th of March 2021 until the 31st of August 2021. The report is laid in draft for a period of 28 days, and representations are invited on the future use of the power as described in the draft report. I look forward to considering members' representations in preparing our final report. I hope that this short introduction has given members helpful background on the important issue of alignment, and look forward to taking any questions. And I'm delighted to be joined by my colleagues, who no doubt will be able to answer any of the more technical aspects of its application by the civil service. Thank you very much, Convener.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I wonder if I could open with a sort of general theme from the submissions and some of the evidence we've indeed heard this morning. And that's really to help our understanding of how the Scottish Government is informed of what's happening in Europe, given that we no longer receive EU directives, and what are the capacity issues for actually being able to take that on board and assess it, and how the Scottish Government might consider communicating those decision-making processes and that information to the wider Parliament and indeed this committee.
So it's this is a situation which is in flux, given the fact that the United Kingdom has only recently left the European Union, and the institutions that were in place to manage the interrelationship between EU institutions and member states, in this case the UK, now a third country, has been changing. Committee members will be aware of the role played by UKREP, the permanent representation of the United Kingdom to the European Union, which was extremely well staffed with extremely competent officials understanding the full breadth of the work of the European Union and its institutions. That has now changed. There is a UK mission, UKMIS, to the European Union, and how it reports to the United Kingdom and, by extension, devolved administrations is also subject to change. So these are things that are not in our power. We did not choose to leave the European Union. We did not choose to downgrade our representation to European Union institutions. And we are having to deal with the consequences of this changing, worsening, in my view, situation. So the way in which we deal with that is that there's a central team within the Scottish Government and the Directorate of External Affairs, which works closely with Scotland House in Brussels and also with Scottish Government lawyers. So I have excellent examples of my colleagues in both of these fields sitting next to me here. And they work in support of the policy directorates across the work of the Scottish Government to consider the government's policy to maintain and advance EU standards where appropriate. The team supports this work as part of DEXA's ongoing business, that is to help enable policy areas to understand the international context of their work. And that team ensures that policy areas consider where alignment may be possible and how they can support ministerial decision-making in considering alignment alongside the range of information and other priorities that government must consider in reaching policy decisions. Now, I have a confession to make before Mr. Ruskell manages to catch your eye in relation to the work of the committee on this very question. I should put on the record that I used to advise the members of this committee in the early stages of devolution in 1999, in 2000, in 2001, on the very question of the scrutiny of European legislation before the committee. I think I'm right in recalling that there is not a single member of the committee now who was on the committee then. So I can just briefly share with you one of the big differences between how you have worked recently and how colleagues worked then was that a considerable amount of time was taken up with what was known as the SIFT of European documentation. How could the committee continue to understand what was coming from European institutions? And what was it that this, as a committee, and by extension the Scottish Parliament, needed to understand about particular European Union regulations, directives, and so on, to ensure that the Parliament and government was best informed about that? During the last 20x years of devolution, this committee has taken the view that that was not an efficient and effective use of the committee's time in maintaining optimal scrutiny of what was emanating from Brussels, and having sat on the European Scrutiny Committee in the House of Commons for 15 years, I can attest to how much time and effort was spent looking at the papers that emerged from Brussels, often with not tremendously great effect. What I would want to flag up to committee, though, which I think might be helpful to you, is that the European memoranda in relation to European proposals, regulations, laws, and so on, is extant. It continues to be produced. So if the committee, if the clerks, if anybody else is wishing to spend a lot of time, and it takes a lot of time to do your individual or collective SIFT, as was done previously by this committee or was done by the European Scrutiny Committee of the House of Commons, the ability is still given to do that if you feel that that is something that you would wish to do.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I'm going to move to questions from committee, and Dr. Allen first. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Something that's, I don't think tangentially, I think it's quite closely relevant to what you're talking about there just now, is your correspondence recently with Lord Frost and about Northern Ireland Protocol and the implications that might have more widely, perhaps, as well, for Scotland as well. Can I ask why you've used quite strong language? Why have you said that you're alarmed by the state of the conversation between the UK and the European Union about the protocol on Northern Ireland?
So, members will be aware that the United Kingdom is currently actively considering whether it should use what are known as Article 16 powers in relation to the Northern Ireland Protocol. That is effectively the UK saying we do not think that the agreements that we agreed and signed with the European Union are fit for purpose unilaterally. And one has had reason to believe in recent weeks, given what has been emanating from discussions with the European Union, that Lord Frost and colleagues are actively considering pursuing this course of action, that is, unilaterally repudiating an agreement which I think I'm right in saying was described as oven-ready and was a huge negotiating success. The consequence of this, if it should be proceeded with, is that notwithstanding the economic damage that Brexit has already caused, and I think members are well cited on the estimates that have been made by neutral organisations assessing the quantum of damage from Brexit being at least twice as that of the coronavirus pandemic, and the impact on UK exports to the biggest single market in the world is down by more than 15%. The view of the Scottish Government is that anything that leads to a yet further worsening, both of relations with the European Union, but also the impact on our economy, would be a hugely retrograde step. That's observation one. Observation two, that the UK government would consider doing such a thing without any active or serious consultation with the devolved administrations of the United Kingdom is yet another sad example of how the devolution settlement and bringing back control from Brussels also means bringing back control from Edinburgh, Cardiff and Belfast, which is a retrograde step. And so we have tried to flag up with Lord Frost, as have a great many people in Northern Ireland, because in the first instance, this deals is related specifically to Northern Ireland and the danger that it would pose turning one's back on the agreement that was reached, that it may lead to a worsening in community relations in Northern Ireland, which is a euphemism for the potential return for violence, which I don't think is in anybody's interests, and all of us should be seized of making sure it doesn't happen. So in answer to your question, Dr. Allen, we are very concerned about the UK's aggressive diplomatic approach. We're very disappointed that it has happened without any active consultation with devolved governments across the UK. I and colleagues in other devolved administrations have called for those discussions to take place before any precipitous decisions are made in relation to Article 16. And I very much hope that the UK government will step back from its threatening position, incidentally, which also, you know, undermines the trust and belief of decision makers in the European Union that the UK is a trusted partner, that it will actually deliver on what it agrees on, which is to our detriment, notwithstanding the fact that we didn't agree with Brexit, notwithstanding the fact that we do not wish for the Northern Ireland Protocol to be treated in the way that it is by the UK government. It is us that is also caught up in the backdraft on all of that. So do we know whether the UK government will proceed with Article repudiating or using Article 16 repudiating the Northern Ireland Protocol? No, we don't. Might it have been a negotiating tactic to try and get some concessions from European institutions who have signalled very loudly that of that they are willing and open to ensuring that improvements that can be made to arrangements can be made. But I would just, as a note, leave the thought with you that should the UK government go ahead, it's widely expected that the European Union will consider countermeasures to the UK's aggressive approach. And what that means is the potential for tariffs being imposed on products from Scotland in relation to the European Union. Now, that it is not, it would not be expected that that would be immediate. There are time factors built into the process, but it is entirely possible that should the UK government continue with its aggressive approach against the European Union, that we may be caught up and our businesses and our exporters may be caught up in the consequences of such a thing. So I would appeal, use this platform to appeal to everybody to keep cool heads, and let's try and ensure that we maintain good relations with the biggest single market in the world, that we improve and not worsen the relationships between the UK government and the European Union. And I note that that has been underlined by a great many people in Northern Ireland, and I hope that the UK government would listen to those as well.
Thank you. And given the continual...
Just
before you go on, can I just say we're moving very far away from the documents that were before us today.
Okay.
Albeit I absolutely agree with the Cabinet Secretary's earlier comment about how this is all very much a moving and flux situation for all of the elements that will affect the decision-making process. But please
well, no, that's what I wanted to ask about. I want to ask about Northern Ireland Protocol, but if that's off topic, I won't ask anything.
Well, I think the Northern Ireland Protocol in the relation to the briefing papers we've had and the evidence this morning in terms of how it might affect the decision-making on the keeping pace powers, if it's around those areas, please continue.
No, it wasn't. It was about the Northern Ireland Protocol, so you can move on.
Okay, thank you very much. Can I bring in Ms Boyack, please?
Thanks very much, Convener. It's been very good to get lots of evidence from a whole range of stakeholders, Cabinet Secretary. And a key issue that comes out from all of them is the issue of transparency. And you mentioned yourself the issue of sifting what's coming next and the major effort that requires for government, but if you could imagine for civil society, for businesses, indeed even for us in the Parliament. So one of the suggestions is thinking about how the Scottish Government can assist that process. There's a suggestion earlier today about potentially having a website that gave the red, orange and green flag on where the Scottish Government intends to align with the EU, where it doesn't intend to align, and where it's thinking about it, maybe a kind of red, orange and green flagging system. I was wondering, have you or your officials thought about that? And have you had joint ministerial discussions within the Scottish Government about how you yourselves might manage and monitor this process and how you would communicate that with, not just with us as a Parliament, but more widely, businesses, civic society, COSLA?
Yeah. So I think that's a very important question, given we're at the start of a process of how do we manage our way through this situation. I mean, I should stress at the outset, I do not want this to go on for as long as it might, and with some fair wind and the acceptance that the people of Scotland have voted in a democratic election, that they should be able to determine their relationship with the European Union within this parliamentary term. With a bit of good fortune and a referendum taking place during this parliamentary term, we can see ourselves on a glide path to rejoining the European Union within the short term. That is my preferred outcome, as it is the Scottish Government's, and I know a majority of members of the Scottish Parliament is as well. In the meantime, we have to find the optimal way in which we can manage the alignment process with the European Union, and it happens across a range of different ways in which the Scottish Government is best able to incorporate, match, exceed European Union standards, also with the view to bear in mind that when we begin reaccession discussions with the European Union after a yes vote in a referendum, we wish Scottish membership of the European Union to be able to happen as quickly with the greatest of ease as possible, and fulfilling the acquis communautaire, as we know, is a key provision of membership of the European Union. Working back from that position, we need to understand that we are now a third country. We are not in the European Union. So it's not as simple as saying every single thing that comes out that emanates from European institutions is instantly transposed and in exactly the same way as was the case while we were within the European Union. I am very seized of this. My officials are very seized of this as well, not just because of the work that the Scottish Government needs to do, but also because of the work that you do, and you want to be informed about how is the Scottish Government dealing with regulations, directives and so on, but very importantly also stakeholders who have a direct or indirect interest and can advise, as we know you've been listening to some of them, and I've read the evidence that's been provided to the committee. So there are a range of ways of which the Scottish Government signals that it is consulting on measures. And I am satisfied that the way that that is working so far in relation to any measures that are considered for alignment is such that stakeholders are properly informed about proposals, that people have the opportunity to take part in such consultations or give advice or share their thoughts. But as I have said at the start, that we are in an emerging situation of making this system work. And it's not a finished product, and I'm very keen that my officials are able to work with clerks of this committee, as an example, of what is the optimal way of being able to make sure that you, and then by extension others, so stakeholders, are best informed about measures that are coming forward. Now, there, you can take the sort of the top line, the strategic approach of European institutions, the annual reports of the Commission and their plans for the years ahead. You have the priorities of the incoming presidencies of the European Union. I think it would be very helpful for the Scottish Government to signal what we anticipate coming through that process and how we intend to remain aligned with those proposals and priorities from the Commission and from the Council presidencies. But then also specific measures, and I don't want to talk too long in answer to one question from Ms. Boyer, but I have a list as an example of particular measures that have gone through this internal process of how do we best manage to retain alignment, which if anybody's interested hearing a little bit more about, I'm happy to share.
Thanks, Cabinet Secretary. There were two specific questions I asked there, so it would be good to get your feedback on it. Firstly was the concept of using a website just to make this all very transparent, and a system where you say where you are intending to keep alignment, where you're not intending to keep alignment, and where you're thinking about it, and being open about that so that the range of different interest groups from civic society, third sector and businesses and COSLA can actually see what's coming next. And the other issue I asked about was ministerial working groups. And I was thinking about that both in terms of ongoing monitoring, but also planning ahead. And I was thinking of that both in terms of internal to the Scottish Government and also that wider UK work with other devolved governments as well as the UK government.
Yep.
Thank you.
So on transparency mechanisms, I'm perfectly happy to take away specific suggestions of how colleagues feel that would be most workable. I'm not, you know, I don't have an ideological position on or an administrative position which says it must be this way or must be that way. I think that's something that we can take away, and we can work with clerks and members of the committee to work out what is the best way of doing this. Secondly, on ministerial working groups, well, this largely operates on an official basis. Things come back from Scotland House in Brussels, and in conjunction with colleagues on the legal side and on the external affairs side, one takes a view on whether proposals are such that alignment measures need to be taken. That has not been escalated to a ministerial working group that I have sat on yet. There's not been an issue that's come up that has needed a cross-departmental approach in that sense, because the way we're making things work is taking it directly into the directorates, directly into the areas of ministerial responsibility. And thus far, there's nothing been flagged that I'm aware of that requires anything more than that. But to give you an example, seeing as I can perhaps flag up some of the areas where alignment has required decisions, just to give you a sense of the scope of this, there are issues relating to Transport Scotland and the transposition of EU directives and secondary legislation being managed through the SSI process. Members will be aware of the issue of single-use plastics, which is an ongoing issue. People will be aware of the ongoing issues around seed potatoes, plant health, gene editing and GMO crops, UK statistics, district heating, and I could go on. So these are active issues where the Scottish Government is working to retain alignment. And I just say that by way of confirming that these are areas where the Scottish Government has been open for consultation and working with interested parties and those that are very closely involved. I mean, take, for example, the seed potato issue, which is a really big issue in the agricultural sector, seeing that our access to the European market has been closed. You know, our interlocutors in this policy area are very well aware of what the position of the Scottish Government is, and we're working very closely with them. So we will do our best to continue to work with stakeholders and with yourselves, and how best we manage that in formats, whether websites, whether SIFTs, whether these different models have been tried. And I think there's just a balance that needs to be struck between how does one do that effectively and efficiently, and how does one not do it that way?
Okay, that's appreciated, because it has been raised by quite a few witnesses, both orally and in written evidence, about that issue of tracking, what your consideration is as a government, and that it would very much help in terms of transparency, and that while an annual report is welcomed, there's what happens for the rest of the year and what the government's forward planning is. And one issue that was raised was not just what has been decided at the EU level, but that capacity to anticipate what's coming next. So I think a commitment on that would be very much welcome from many witnesses. Thank you.
So totally understood. And probably something I should have added was that the undertaking to ensure that in relation to any proposed legislation in the Scottish Parliament, that it is clearly flagged up, the alignment status around those issues. So in specifically related to legislation, that there is an awareness of how that figures in.
Both where there is legislation and where you're using other methods, or deciding explicitly not to use legislation,
yep,
or to act. Thank you very much.
Yep.
Thank you. Mr. Ruskell?
In a similar vein, that wider transparency is important, because obviously the report that's before us right now, it only speaks to the use of those Section 1 powers. It doesn't talk about alignment in its most broadest sense, which, as Ms. Boyack is explaining, is about the legislation, but it's also about the interpretation of law as well. I'm just sort of thinking to moving on from that conversation about what those different levels could be. I mean, you've described some of the challenges of parliamentary committees in terms of the SIFT.
Mm.
You've also talked about, you know, there generally being consultation with stakeholders on these areas. What kind of in-depth information can we get, particularly in those areas, as you say, where there may be a divergence that's in Scotland's interests? How can that actually be flagged up at a level that is appropriate to both committee and stakeholders? Because it's not really clear in the report that's before us right now. And it's clear there have been decisions which in many ways perhaps have diverged Scotland from the European Union.
So, well, firstly, the position of the Scottish Government is we wish to remain aligned with the European Union. But I think you're drawing attention to the fact is where might there be cases where there is a degree of, and I'm looking to colleagues here if there's anything that they specifically wanted to flag up. I mean, there are plenty of examples of us wanting to retain enhanced standards. And, you know, so divergence in that sense doesn't necessarily mean one is making a decision that is having a lessening of standards. It may very well be, and I know that there are specific, often very technical cases of wanting to make sure that the standards are even higher. But I get the point at issue, which is how is one fully aware of all of this? And this is, I think, there have been discussions between clerks and colleagues about exploring ways in which that can happen. And I'm very keen and I'm open to us understanding what the best way of taking that forward is. And you know, we've had a suggestion from Ms. Boyack about one way of doing it. One can have a very paper-based system. One can realise that a very paper-based system will take up all of your time and will not actually help you have a laser-like focus on the areas that you're probably most interested to have, and I'm wanting to be helpful in that respect. So we're looking at different ways in which can. Is there anything at this point that colleagues want to add?
In terms of an example in which we haven't aligned, one that I would probably flag is a UK measure that we consented to, and that's the UK Statistics SI and the Concordat on Statistics. The SI in question repeals the remaining EU regulations that oblige the UK to transmit statistics to Eurostat, very much a consequence of Brexit. But we are obviously no longer in alignment with that requirement. Although that said, it's important to highlight that the Concordat advocates certain standards in terms of the provision of statistical information. And the Scottish Government has been quite clear that we will remain in alignment with that outcome, even though the process in question has changed. Another example that I might mention also is the Heat Network Scotland Act 2021. In that regard, the legislation was passed to allow district heating schemes to be established in Scotland with greater ease. So that aligns very closely with the EU measures, but it's not a clear-cut situation. And this is one piece of legislation that illustrates quite well that alignment decisions are not necessarily a simple matter of aligning or not aligning, because that aspect of the Heat Networks Scotland Act does align with the EU, but there is also parts of that EU directive that relate to consumer protection, and the consumer protection sections are reserved to the UK government, and the progression of that I think is an ongoing process. So we're making representations to the UK government on how best to ensure that there's any UK wide consumer protection legislation that could be implemented in Scotland that would take account of our interests in terms of establishing heat networks, easier establishment of heat networks.
I think that's useful, and I think Cabinet Secretary explained it well earlier on, where you talked about those elements which are effectively redundant, the laws that are redundant now because we're just out of the structure of the European Union, those areas where perhaps powers are reserved in the settlement that we have. But there are also those conscious decisions to diverge. And I think it's the transparency around that which is missing at the moment. Perhaps if I could just give you an example. Mm-hmm. So I think an assumption has been made that we are in alignment with the EU and the EU's climate change laws, because we have our own, you know, climate change legislation that was updated quite recently and has enhanced targets that actually go beyond the EU's law. However, I'm doing a piece of work with a colleague in the Bundestag at the moment around the EU taxonomy, which is effectively part of the EU law, around which sectors are deemed to be climate neutral and therefore worthy of investment within the European Union. Now, this is a big area of policy debate within the EU at the moment. I'm sure the Cabinet Secretaries are aware of that, not just in Germany, but elsewhere. Are we aligned with that or not? Are we aligned with the EU taxonomy on green investment, which is a part of the climate law? Has there been consideration of that? And where did the conversation go? So that's one example of where I'm not entirely clear.
That specific example, I'm not aware of the position. I would need to speak to colleagues. I'm not the lead official for that area.
Alignment of the EU policy, like climate, you know.
No, indeed. I mean, it's a key part of the Commission work plan for 2022 is the Fit for 55 package and the range of methods that the EU is considering taking forward in this working year in order to meet its climate targets and enhance its climate targets. And that is an area that colleagues in the Directorate for Climate Change are considering very closely. Exactly how we respond to that is still under consideration, but we can certainly provide more information on that.
So that kind of shows, I think, Convener, the kind of level of, you know, information that it would be useful, I think, perhaps for wider stakeholders to understand as well, particularly if we're going to go into debate about joining the EU. We might like what's in the EU taxonomy, we might like the way that European investment is going, we may not. So I feel that's an example of where that kind of level of information and consideration within the Scottish Government, I hope there is consideration of that.
Look, and this is entirely helpful. I mean, this is the purpose of having a session like this, is to gauge what it is that you as members of the committee and then the Scottish Parliament more widely regard as being the optimal way in which you can understand processes. Our default position is the government wishes Scottish legislation to be de minimis in alignment with the European Union. That is our position. That you
unless
would,
it's in Scotland's interests, indeed.
Right. But the baseline position is that we're trying to remain as aligned as we can, and it makes sense to be with the European Union. For you to then be able to understand how is that working in relation to specific measures, I understand that you know you have queries about how that works. You also have a range of ways in which, if you're unaware of that, about how I, as the Cabinet Secretary with lead responsibility for external affairs, can answer that through direct questions in the Chamber, through written questions, and through statements by the Scottish Government in relation to specific legislation. So there is a I think possibly what we need to do is draw together the range of ways in which one can access information about things so that it's obvious how does one do that, how can one do that, for us to make absolutely clear about how we're going to flag up and incorporate information about the processes that we are using in relation to specific legislation and specific proposals by the European Union, and if there are additional ways that we can proportionately answer those kind of queries, Ms. Boyack's suggestions of a website, people are interested in paper. You know, these are all things that can be looked at. From our perspective, it's just how do we get a balance between doing what we're doing, because we are remaining aligned, that is what we're doing, but how do we make sure that you have as much information as you can, as you require for your purposes to scrutinise the government's work, and entirely open to considering how we best do that.
Okay.
Mr. Cameron.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. Those of us, I think, who were here in the last session and are sort of veterans of both continuity bills as they went through Parliament, recall your predecessor, Mike Russell, saying that the keeping pace powers were crucial and necessary. I can hear his voice even now saying that. But the fact remains that they haven't been used, and perhaps more strikingly, there are no current plans to use them. And I think, given that background, we're entitled to ask why not? And I ask that question with two important background points. Firstly, there has been a huge amount of EU legislation in the last year. I think a total of 1,650 legal acts have gone through this year. And secondly, to reinforce the points that both Sarah Boyack and Mark Ruskell have said, a lot of people who've made submissions to us, I think, want greater rationale, greater sort of explanation as to, decision to align or not, you know, and why that's, why those decisions have been taken.
Well, I'm sure Mr. Russell will be delighted that he's in your thoughts, and you obviously have the advantage of having been involved in this process at a time that I was not. So I deal with the ball as it is at my feet, and can flag up to the committee that you obviously know that the power is there in legislation for it to be used. And it is the intention of the Scottish Government to do so. It's just not within the current reporting period, so I can draw your attention to it. It's perhaps something that you might want to come back to understand how it is that these decisions are made. And this is specifically in relation to the recast Drinking Water Directive, which came into force on the 12th of January 2021, following formal adoption by the European Parliament on the 16th of December 2020. There's a two-year transposition window. And the Water Scotland Act 1980 provides for regulations to be made insofar as they relate to standards that water for human consumption must meet. However, the recast directive introduces a much wider set of requirements, such as those relating to risk assessments of catchments, supply systems, internal plumbing systems, and so on. And I'm just flagging up to you that this is an area where we are looking at using the powers. Now, of course, when government ministers have said it's very important that one has this legal club in the metaphorical bag to be used in certain circumstances, and it hasn't been used yet, of course, the question then is, well, why did one need the power in the first place? Well, one needed the power in the first place because it is exactly for circumstances like this. I suppose, having had a close look at this whole area, it just strikes me that because of the range of ways in which government can legislate, can introduce regulations is very broad, as you well know, as a lawyer, that one seeks to use the most sensible way of doing that. And being pragmatic, government has sought to make sure that one does that in the most appropriate way. So what I'm saying in short order is it was proposed for a good reason. It's there for a good reason. It is going to be used for a good reason, just hasn't been used yet. And other methods have been used to deliver the intent of the Scottish Government, which is to retain alignment with the European Union.
Thank you for that. I mean, that brings me on to my next question, which is there are other means of alignment, if I could put it like that, either through primary or secondary legislation. You've helpfully provided a table where you describe what you've transposed using just an SSI. I think what would help would be to help us understand where do you make that choice? Why do you make that choice? Why do you use other secondary legislation and not the keeping pace power? And I was interested in your comment at the very beginning, Cabinet Secretary, when you described keeping pace power as a backstop. Is that how you see it? Is it a safety net where all else fails and or there's just no other way to do it? Is that the best way of understanding the Section 1 power?
Well, I think it's probably appropriate to defer to the legal colleague on the legal aspects of this. But I don't think it's too difficult to get one's head around the fact that there are different ways in which government can regulate, can retain alignment, and the speed with which one can do that, the efficiency with which one can do that, and it's just a case of trying to work out which is the best of the clubs in the bag, and I'm now using it for the second time, and I'm not a very good golfer, to make sure that we are incorporating or retaining alignment within legislation in Scotland. But perhaps my legal colleague will be able to fill in some of the gaps.
I just add that the Section 1-1 power is largely a replacement for the Section 2-2 power in the European Communities Act 1972. And the Scottish Government's policy on using subject-specific powers to align with EU law in preference to the general Section 1-1 power is in line with the approach previously taken to the use of Section 2-2 of the European Communities Act.
So in effect, it's we're trying to maintain a continuity of practice in how we are doing things. So whilst it is evolving in the sense that we're trying to find our way through how do we use the new legislation, how do we work with the new realities of a UK as a third state, and how is it that we apply our administrative approaches to making sure that we are delivering on the alignment target, it's one that we're using the full panoply of measures. But then that was also something that was done previously as well. So it's not new.
Sorry, just to come back on that, I think two points are important, that there is a difference. Firstly, under the previous provision, you were mandated to do this, whereas this is now a policy choice. And secondly, there is we can argue the pros and cons forever, but there is now an absence of input at EU level from UK government, Scottish government, as a result of Brexit. Would you accept that that's, I mean, there are differences now in terms of how that worked?
So, yes, absolutely. And my view and the government's view is it's entirely detrimental, no longer being in the room, no longer being able to influence the decisions that are being made as at a European Union level, and we seek to change that. But I mean, it's just a description of the facts, Mr. Cameron. You're absolutely right. So there is a change in circumstances, and we need to make sure that we're making the best decisions in the best possible way in those circumstances.
Ms. Mintel?
Returning to the transparency issues. We've taken evidence last week and this week from various organisations that have raised concerns about I'll use the phrase race to the bottom, that if we're not aligning with EU law, so whether in environmental, public health, and today we also heard about human rights. I'm interested to know how, I suppose from a transparency perspective, the Scottish Government is liaising with organisations like that to allow us to learn, I suppose, from experiences that they have and connections that they have across the EU or more widely with regards to laws, legislations that impact on these areas.
So there's a full panoply of engagement, and I'm sure many of you around the table here will probably reflect on the flat fact that we spend half our life in Teams meetings, and I certainly do. And whether that's meeting with COSLA or meeting with any number of other organisations and our colleagues in government, dealing with stakeholders, and some of whom you've taken evidence from, and it's very helpful to get. I mean, as I have said in previous evidence sessions to the committee, I think having input from these stakeholders shows its value, because it allows us to reflect on how are things working, or how do we need to do more of something or less of something. And I'll stress it again, we are very interested to make sure we're doing this as well as we can. The intention of the Scottish Government is to retain what we believe will be the higher standards of the European Union, as opposed to the race to the bottom being signalled by the approach of the United Kingdom government in no longer being part of the European Union. So if anybody is concerned that decisions are being made in Scotland which are aimed at diverging and diluting the higher standards of the European Union, I can give an absolute assurance that that is diametrically opposed to the aims of the Scottish government. If we look at trade agreements that are being forged by the UK government that illustrate decisions which are a weakening of standards when measured against the those that previously agreed by the European Union, I think we are right to be concerned about a race to the bottom. But the race to the bottom is not by the Scottish government. We are racing to try and maintain the high standards and in their own right, so we have the highest standards, but also so that when we rejoin the European Union, that we are able to do so with the greatest of negotiating ease, because we are effectively fulfilling the standards of the acquis communautaire.
Thank you. One of the questions that we specifically got asked today was, previously, organisations like that would have had funds or applied to funds from Europe to help their structure to enable them to feed in. Probably not a question for you, Cabinet Secretary, but I suppose just bringing the plea to the Scottish Government to recognise that within the up-and-coming budget.
So thank you for putting that on the record. You have the advantage of having been in the evidence session beforehand, which I was not, but it's very helpful. I mean, we do go through the evidence that's given, both written and orally, and take away suggestions that are made and to consider them. Yeah, it's for a long time, Scottish organisations were represented in Brussels, co-located in the same building. And I think it was an excellent model that ensured that from local government to, you name the different organisations that had an interest in European Union decision making, were there in the same building with officials from the Scottish Government. And it's very much a model that I would wish us to repeat when we become a member state of the European Union, because it is clearly the best model. It's specifically relating to the absence of funding. Well, we don't have enough time in this evidence session to look at the replacement of existing European Union schemes with the anemic, underpowered replacement versions from the UK government. Look at what's happened in Erasmus. Look at how much less is being spent in the Turing scheme. Look at how much less is being spent in relation to economic support compared to the structural funds and other regional funds of the European Union through the UK. And this is no doubt another area where, unfortunately, people will find that they are in a worse off position than they were when we were part of the European Union. So we'll definitely take that away. I want people to be informed. I want people to have the administrative capacity to be able to inform and influence government thinking and decision making. And I will definitely take that away. Obviously, we live in constrained times, and if the finance secretary was sitting here, no doubt she would be impressing on me the need for us to be financially responsible, and we are, of course, but we need to ensure that we have the best governance that we can have. So if there's a feeling that it might not be obvious who is making that point, please can that be shared with myself and officials, and we'll have a look at any specific proposals that are made.
Okay. Thank you very much. I got supplementary from Ms. Boyack on that area, and then I'll come to Mr. Golden.
Yep. Thanks very much, Convener. It was just to follow up on that issue, because I think that's a very valuable area of questioning. One of the things that was suggested by some of our witnesses was the concept of different forums that could be held where you could exchange best practice, and it helps people keep up with what's happening in Europe. It's on a briefing basis, and it links very much with a point that COSLA made about their joint links that they have with other local governments across the EU, and it was to bring that together, which would help the third sector. It raises the civic society connections, but it would also be good in terms of transparency, I think, for businesses, and I think for us in terms of parliamentary scrutiny. Thanks.
So, yes. Just by way of illustration, this is exactly a point that was made in discussion that I had with the voluntary sector. So the SCVO, which is another is another area which has had extremely positive and mature links with colleagues across the rest of the European Union, and is an erstwhile colleague, very well versed in how Europe works. Irene Oldfather, I think, is involved in that. And colleagues there were extremely keen to make sure that we are using the links that Scottish civic society has, and so by extension local government, and by extension professional organisations and so on, to make sure that we are fully cited on developments. And yes, I think we need to look at all ways in which we can make sure that we are up to speed, best coordinated, best practiced. What are we doing with this? What are we doing with that? And definitely take that away and work out the format. I mean, I would say, and giving the example of speaking with the SCVO, we are already having those kind of discussions. But the question about the format of that, the regularity of that, the extent to which it is structured around particular proposals that are emanating from Europe, perhaps, or the priorities of the Commission or the priorities in incoming presidency, I think we want to be flexible about making sure that we're capturing that experience, that insight, and that goodwill. And I think that's a very, very good suggestion.
I think the advanced planning and advanced notice would help, because then you would draw
understood
on that expertise, but
totally
it would
understand
also address the transparency issue, which mm-hmm comes across really strongly in the evidence.
Yeah.
Thanks.
But there's also a flip side to this, Ms. Boyack, which is that we have colleagues in the third sector who themselves are involved in projects and planning and priorities, and we may not be aware of what those are. So it's a two-way street, and I completely agree. We want to make sure that we are, in this sense, as best aligned as possible on this. Forgive me. Yeah.
It's just to highlight, I mean, there are probably two key documents that I would mention here as well. And the first is the Scottish Government's approach to policymaking. And this document sets out exactly how we take forward the policy process, and a key part of that is consultation with stakeholders. The Scottish Government values stakeholder input. We acknowledge that a wider range of interests, a wider range of expertise leads to better policy making, And so that is part and parcel of our standard approach towards the development of any policy. And the second thing I would mention would be the Scottish Government's international framework, which sets out that there are opportunities to be had and there are experiences to be gained from engaging with the international fora, and particularly in the European Union, in developing our approach to policy. Because we acknowledge that there is potentially impacts or there's things to be learned about the approach to take forward there. It's therefore a requirement for all policy areas, all policy directorates in their area of specialisation to take consideration of both of those documents. So in their engagement with stakeholders, whether it's about legislation, whether it's about policy development, we would expect them to be having those conversations. So as the Cabinet Secretary said, we may be unaware of the exact engagement that's taken place across every single policy area. That is part and parcel of the job of developing policy.
So just a final thought of that. On notwithstanding the ongoing policy engagement that takes place, I do see the advantage of speaking with those organisations like COSLA, like the SCVO. There are others, no doubt, and you know, any suggestions that colleagues have about who might want to take part in such a thing. I think it would make sense for us to take that away and explore with these organisations about how is it that we can best work together with this specific aim in mind. And I'm very keen to do that.
Thank you. It helps you as a government.
Indeed.
It helps them, but also helps us in terms of parliamentary scrutiny. Indeed. If we are kept up to speed with that. Thank
Indeed.
You.
Yep.
Okay. Mr. Ruskell, is that supplementary in this area?
Very brief point on the back of that. When the previous committee in the last session was looking at the replacement regulations for REACH, one of the points that the NGOs raised at the time is that they very much valued the EU Policy Development Forum, not just in terms of policy development, but ongoing scrutiny and evolution of those regulations over time within the EU. And there was a real sense of loss that those forums had not been replaced with the UK REACH regulations, and effectively now NGOs were maybe consulted, but they weren't involved in actually co-producing the regulations and in their ongoing scrutiny and evolution going forward. So there's something about the depth of EU policy making which has been lost, and I think it's worth reflecting on as well.
I think more than reflecting, I think we need to see if there's anything about how we are working with things that might be considered by some people to be not as as engaging and involving. And if there are things that we should take from that process to heart about how we do things and do things differently, do more, do less, do differently, then I'm very, very open to doing that. Because it is, I mean, it's one of the tragedies about leaving the European Union is that much of its work and it's the work of its institutions was not newsworthy in the sense that from day to day it provided headlines. It was because the iterative process that the European institutions used were such that it brought people along, whether as member states or as the different parts of civic life, and that is, you know, a huge loss, I think. So in the meantime, let's do what we can. Let's try and learn best practice, and let's get back into the European Union as a member state as quickly as we possibly can.
Mr. Golden.
I won't sign you up to that, Mr. Golden.
Thank you, Convener. I always enjoyed my time on the Committee of the Regions, a very important forum that I hope in some way, shape or form we can continue to feed in to that process. Just on the... We discussed the consultation exercises. Where there's a decision not to use powers, what sort of consultation exercises conducted with COSLA and relevant stakeholders?
Well, I'll defer to colleagues on the technical aspects of any specific on any specific measures. I mean, when I have looked at what has emanated from European decision-making, there's not a long list of things that we're not proceeding with. We're trying to remain aligned. So the things that are, which are the easiest to explain that one doesn't align with are There are examples of water control measures applying to Mediterranean nations. Those are not things that we need to align with, because we're not a Mediterranean. We're not a Mediterranean nation. Now, there's all kinds of examples, and that's that. To me, having reviewed all of this, that's the biggest single reason why something is not proceeded with, is it just has absolutely no impact on us whatsoever in the current framework of us being a third-party state. And I'm not aware of any significant proposals where we have taken the view, well, we're not proceeding with that, and we're not remaining aligned because, you know, we think that's a terrible idea. It tends to be things are not being proceeded with just because it does not impact on us. And, you know, I don't want to sort of pluck ideas of or particular measures off the top of my head. I'm sure my colleagues might have a list of regulations or directives that have nothing to do with us, but, you know, there's quite a lot of them. Were we a member state, of course we would need to do what we would have needed to do as a member state, but given our circumstances as we currently find ourselves outside the European Union, we don't need to.
But is there routine consultation, even however brief, or, you know, where it seems, you know, as the Mediterranean example you provided, although I would say that Dundee is the Milan of the North, so perhaps we. But is there routine consultation?
I hope I'm not opening up to a can of worms, but I don't think the Scottish Government liaised with Dundee City Council about regulations pertaining to water management in the Mediterranean. I do understand that there is a tension between the wish to have maximum transparency and wanting to understand about every single proposal. And I said at the start, I have lived in that world, and I, having sat on your side of the fence, and gone through week in, week out, piles and piles and piles of things which are largely not relevant or interesting. I understand that there's still a way, but I still would like to see, if I could, please, thank you very much. I get that, but I'm sure there is an appreciation from members about the tension involved between that and just saying, listen, there are a whole range of things that we don't need to consult, because it has absolutely nothing to do with us. I'm seeing my colleague's hand here. Here we're going to get some examples of regulations that have nothing to do with us.
I could do that, yes. One is the habitats directives I could mention, where there are specific mentions of particular habitats in Europe or particular species of animal in Europe that are protected. It would make no sense to, you know, make efforts to try and apply that in Scotland, because it doesn't apply in Scotland. There are regulations upcoming, I think, on product standards that will go into extremely detailed recommendations around, say, the exact size of product labelling in a particular context. Aspects like that are very small technical or operational decisions, which ultimately, when we consider that against outcome-based policymaking, which is what our approach is, doesn't alter the outcome that we're seeking to achieve, and that is to remain in broad alignment with the European Union and to ensure that we protect and advance the standards that we enjoyed as a member of the European Union. I think there's been something of the order of between 1,000 and 2,000 pieces of EU legislation, somewhere around that, already since late 2020. The vast majority of that is technical, but is operational. And, you know, going through that with a detailed analysis or consideration of exactly how it does not apply is not something that we would expect to be prioritising, because the application or non-application would be obvious. And I think the point I'd maybe sort of come back to as well is that where something is relevant or where there is a factor in there that we need to consider, again, our approach to consultation and our approach to policy making stands. You know, it would be very strange for the Scottish Government not to consult with COSLA about something that would impact local government responsibilities. So we would carry out that consultation, and we would replicate that across policy areas where it was relevant.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Cameron, final question.
Just to pursue that, because there may be situations where the Scottish Government chooses positively not to align with EU EU law in whatever way. So for, I'm just trying to think of an example, but say the EU took a view on the use of pesticides that was just did not meet the same policy aims as a Scottish government. Do you accept that there would be situations where you might choose not to align, not simply because it was not relevant or unnecessary, but there may be divergence?
So yes, and this is a very good example, because there is an example in relation to plant health where there has been a divergence upwards. So this makes the point about what is the policy objective of the Scottish Government in relation to the European Union? It is that we remain aligned as best we can, using the different ways which we've been outlining in evidence. But where things come along where we think we would want to have enhanced standards, that is exactly what we have been doing. So it's not, I mean, I understand people want to be assured that we're not, and I'm delighted that we're hearing that as well from the Conservative benches, that we're not wanting to see a diminution of standards. If there has been a divergence, and in this particular area, it's one that has been flagged up to me, we have sought to have higher standards. I'm not going to pronounce it properly. Xylella, is that correct?
That's correct.
Fantastic. I got the pronunciation correct. But that's an apposite and timely example of the approach that has been taken in Scotland to that. It is not to diverge in the sense of we are wishing to disapply or have significantly worse standards to things. It is that we would de minimis want to have the same standards, but higher. Incidentally, something which was open to the United Kingdom government and the Scottish government prior to us being taken out of the European Union against our wishes.
Can I just answer? I haven't said it was a final question, a supplementary on that,
yep.
That area, Cabinet Secretary. So so you said that you've gone to a higher standard than the European Union, and there is now divergence, but the UK government have not. So it's one of these areas, so something that has been raised in evidence today is about how that might affect market access principles in the UK on particularly that pesticide. Mm. Could you just explain what you think the outcomes of that might be?
So I know I will give colleagues a moment to think about that specific to this issue of the product in question. More generally, it has been an apposite question specifically in relation to single-use plastics. And this is where the Internal Market Act intersects with the common framework arrangements which preceded the Internal Market Act. That was the ability by which one could see divergence in policy in different parts of the UK that was agreed by the United Kingdom in the floor of the House of Lords. And it has been something that I have been trying to make progress on in recent months. Now, some good news to share with the committee. Last week, I chaired a meeting on common frameworks with the UK government, with the Welsh government, with the Northern Irish government, on making progress with common frameworks. And I have to say, in stark contrast to the experience that I have made, which is suboptimal, it's an example that it is possible to make progress with things. And I would like to commend my colleagues from the UK government and from Wales and Northern Ireland and our officials involved in this, because should the common frameworks operate in the way that they can, it means that it is possible to make the kind of decisions that we want to on single-use plastics, for example, regardless of the approach being taken by the UK government. And that may apply elsewhere, specifically to the point you were raising, convener. I don't know if there's anything that either of my colleagues would wish to raise specific to that. Oh, I'm informed that the UK government has chosen to do the same as the Scottish government on Xylella. So I commend them for following the lead of the Scottish government.
So welcome that clarification on that particular product. By way of an example of what might happen, I'm not sure it will be as easy for everything else going forward. Cabinet Secretary, thank you very much for your attendance at committee this morning. And can I thank your officials from the Scottish Government this morning. We're going to suspend and go into private session.